This week, you delivered your verdict.
Boy, I tell you what, after this primary, our swords are sharp and our shields are thick.
We congratulated him on a hard-fought victory.
Voters on Tuesday made Missouri the 38th state to approve expanding Medicaid.
Charisse, you are now officially on notice.
We look at our election week's biggest winners and losers and ask what happens next.
Week in Review is made possible through the generous support of Dave and Jamie Cummings, Bob and Marlise Gorley, Haas and Wilkerson Insurance, the Courtney S. Turner Charitable Trust, John H. Mize, and Bank of America N.A. co-trustees. And by viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome, I'm Nick Haines. The biggest lessons from Election Day in our Metro, plus the week's other top stories. So much to unpack, and helping us to make sense of what happened and why, keeping you up to date on KCUR News, Steve Kraske. From the Tribune News Service, nationally syndicated columnist Mary Sanchez. From KMBC 9 News, chief political reporter Michael Mahoney. And from the pages of your Kansas City Star, Dave Helling. Now, this week marked the biggest test of our election system since the pandemic began. How did we do? Did we get a passing grade, Steve Kraske?
Oh, I think we got a passing grade. I mean, I went into election night, Nick, thinking we might get results 3 years from now. Turned out we got them quickly that same night, despite all these gloom and doom forecasts. That was the biggest surprise of the night, as far as I was concerned.
Yeah, and that's what you said, Michael Mahoney, last week. We may be until next week before we ever see some of the big results.
Well, yeah, and I'll tell you why it didn't happen like that. And I expected it to be a long night. I took extra shirts to the station. One of the reasons was there were no close races, relatively speaking, on the big races. And the other thing, in the state of Kansas, among those 315,000 folks that asked for a mail-in advance ballot to be sent to them, 4 out of 5 of those folks sent them right back in. And so they had a huge body of them and not that many late returns or day of returns or postmarks on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, which they count. People got them, they filled them out, and they sent them back in.
Mary, this was also the very first time that many of us for months got to go into an indoor place if we wanted to without wearing a mask. You didn't have to wear a mask to vote in Kansas and Missouri. Any evidence that was causing any conflicts at the polls this week?
I didn't hear of any of that. I know just within my personal own polling place, you know, I wore a mask, everyone had on a mask. It would be interesting though to hear more from the outskirts, more from suburban areas, if perhaps that was. I haven't heard it though. I think people who were ready to vote knew that they needed to be safe when they went into those facilities, and so they wore the mask.
I want to get into the races in just a moment, but there were some trends that happened, Dave Helling, and we knew there were problems in Clay County with election machines. Does that throw out all of the results? Do we have to re-examine Medicaid expansion in Missouri? And did Governor Parson really win the governor's primary there in Missouri as a result of those Clay County election problems?
Yeah, I don't think that those results will be thrown out, Nick, but there will be a recount. And it is troubling, isn't it, that in Clay County, apparently lots of votes were miscounted or not counted at all. We should get the real results in that problem later next week. I will say I had a chance to visit 8 different polling places in Kansas City on Election Day, and everyone was wearing a mask, and there was social distancing, and all of the rules were followed. But I will tell you that if the turnout in November is as high as we expect it to be, the ability to socially distance, to cast ballots at a reasonable time frame is going to be very, very problematic. That's why I think the Kansas write-in experience was so important, because writing in, mailing in ballots seems to be so much easier and better for most voters than actually showing up on Election Day.
Now, we'll look at primary election day's biggest winners and losers, but here in less than 45 seconds are all the big results from Tuesday night. Are you ready? Chris Kobach comes up short in his quest to become the next United States Senator from Kansas, Republican voters picking Western Kansas Congressman Roger Marshall to take on Democrat Barbara Beaulieu in the fall. In another crowded race, Cerner executive Amanda Adkins comes out on top in the Republican primary for the Kansas 3rd Congressional District. A congressman no more, Steve Watkins loses his bid for re-election in the Kansas 2nd District. Medicaid expansion approved in Missouri, 53% of those casting ballots voting yes to that. Jackson County Sheriff Darrell Forte given 4 more years on the job by voters. And in another race we profiled last week, Mark Dupree gets a second term as the Wyandotte County DA. Steve Kraske, complete this sentence for me. The biggest winner on primary election day in our metro was blank.
Nick, there were two big winners. Poor Missourians, their lives are going to be transformed by Medicaid expansion. Very important for them. Secondly, a big winner, Charisse David. She got the opponent she wants here, Nick. Amanda Atkins is capable, she's smart, she's savvy, but she's also very, very closely tied to Sam Brownback, having served as a campaign manager and a state chairman for him. Sam Brownback is not very popular in the 3rd District. Charisse David is going to wrap Sam Brownback around her neck the whole campaign.
Do you agree with that, Dave Helling? You know, I thought that Amanda Atkins would be the worst opponent for Charisse David.
Well, we'll see. I mean, she's certainly a quality candidate in terms of her political skills. But Steve is right. The Sam Brownback connection will be important, and the Donald Trump connection, which is big in the 3rd District, as we know. I can tell you who I think the winner is, though, Nick, and that is conservatives who ran for state legislative seats in Kansas. The wipeout of moderates in the legislature, the Senate, and the House in primaries was extraordinary. And Laura Kelly, the governor, is now facing, if Democrats can't win those races, is facing a long, long 2 years on the other side of November.
Mary Sanchez, who did you pick as your biggest winner on election night?
Roger Marshall, because of the gaps, you know, how far ahead he made it, and that he made in Johnson County as well. I mean, that really bodes well for him going into the November elections. The other, kind of as a secondary, would be Mark Dupree, because he survived the attacks that were coming towards him. You know, he was elected on the idea of he would be a change agent. So now he has a little bit more time to kind of show that stuff.
I would say Mitch McConnell was the biggest winner in the Kansas primary.
I didn't see him on the ballot here.
Well, he was. He was all over your TV, I assure you. And because he got the Kansas Senate candidate once. I look at the other side of what Dave said, the biggest loser, being Kansas moderates in the Republican Party, for the very reason that he stated. They took it right in the chops.
Okay, so that, if that's your biggest loser on primary election day, who was your biggest loser, Steve Kraske?
Chris Kobach, Nick. This is the second statewide election he's lost in 2 years. Obviously lost the big race for governor in 2018 in a Republican state. Loses this time. You got to wonder if he's not, his political career isn't over.
Could he have won that race if Bob Hamilton wasn't in it? After all, he got 20% of the vote in that election.
You know, you can make that argument. Hamilton might have taken votes from Roger Marshall, too. And Bob, Roger Hamilton didn't. Bob Hamilton, I'm getting my Hamiltons mixed up. Alexander Hamilton didn't yeah, really right. wind
well,
up.
Adam Hamilton, for that matter, yes.
Yeah, well, I thought he had great ads, but it just didn't work for him.
Mary, who did you have as your biggest loser?
It would be Chris Kobach, just because, you know, here's a candidate who his own party was against him. I do not think you've heard the last of him, though, however. I mean, he's already so attached on these issues of immigration. He was down at the border helping to build that wall privately funded that is now falling in. So
is that the end of Chris Kobach, though, for elected office, Dave?
Well, you would think so. I mean, he's lost twice now statewide, once in his own party, once in a general election. It's going to be very difficult to see where he might go next, Nick, for elected office. I mean, he might run for Congress, but I don't see that as likely. I mean, he has a future, obviously, in his wing of the Republican Party and writing and appearances and legal work. So I don't think we have to worry about his future. His political future may be over.
Who was your biggest loser on election night?
Well, I would say the Todd Akin approach to campaign commercials. You know, the Democrats tried to promote Kobach by airing a commercial that said Chris Kobach is just too conservative. He's against the wall. That was first done by Claire McCaskill, of all people, in the Todd Akin race, and she later claimed that she helped him get the nomination. People are wise to that tactic now. And frankly, in primaries, people aren't voting strategically. They're voting for the candidate that they want, so that looks like it's over.
Why didn't anyone say that Barbara Beaulieu was one of their biggest losers? Wasn't she supposed to be crying in her boots if Chris Kobach didn't win this primary, Michael Mahoney?
No, I don't think so. She would have preferred, and the Democrats obviously preferred to run against Kobach, but they have confidence in the Beaulieu campaign. She's got $4 million, which is an awful lot more money than Roger Marshall has got. He's probably spending this weekend working the phones for money. They believe that, you know, they've got a puncher's chance, as they say in the boxing business. Is it a long shot? Yeah.
Voters were also deciding, of course, in Missouri, as Steve mentioned, the Medicaid expansion, which was approved by 53% of voters saying yes to that. What did Tuesday's result tell us? And does it offer us any lessons as we look at issues and races that will be decided this fall in our area, Steve?
Well, you know, again, one big lesson is that moderate Kansans are facing a reckoning they haven't faced in a very long time. Continued difficulties here. I think it's also interesting in Missouri, Nick, voters back Medicaid expansion despite the pleas of a governor and the Republican establishment saying we can't afford the $200 million this is going to cost us. But voters still went ahead and did it. It'll be interesting to see if this is a sign of renewed Democratic vigor in Missouri in the fall. You got signs that in Kansas, the Democratic turnout was way up in the primary, despite the fact there wasn't really anything on the ballot. That was interesting to me, too.
Michael.
I think one of the things that's really interesting to look at on the Medicaid expansion vote, actually, there are two. Number one, this took place during the middle of a pandemic. You cannot underestimate the impact of that. Secondly, they won this not in Kansas City nor in St. Louis. They won it in the suburbs of the big cities. St. Louis County voted for it. Clay County, one of the bellwethers in the entire state of Missouri in terms of politics, it carried there. It carried in Platte County. The other bellwether, Jefferson County over in the St. Louis area, defeated Medicaid expansion. The Democrats are very happy that it performed the way it did in the suburbs because they think that's the battleground in state politics this fall and nationally.
Just because, though, it was passed, does that mean it's going to be implemented fully, Dave Helling? I just remember thinking back on 2018, just 2 years ago, marijuana was passed, medical marijuana passed in the state of Missouri. We're still waiting for any dispensaries to open 2 years later. And then Clean Missouri was passed by voters 2 years ago. And now it's back on the ballot this November to actually roll back many of the components of that.
I think a lot of people are paying attention to how Medicaid is implemented. There are timelines embedded in the law that voters have approved, but it's going to take a real effort by someone to make sure that those standards are met. I do think the Medicaid vote was an interesting signal to Governor Mike Parson. His popularity is dropping because of COVID. There is confusion and concern about the state's response, and now voters went to the polls in pretty high numbers and approved rather comfortably this big expansion that he was diametrically opposed to. So my guess is the Parson campaign, if you will, is taking a close look at those numbers and understand that they've got a race on their hands.
Do you see, though, a walking back of this in the Missouri legislature? You can also put up lots of restrictions to prevent Medicaid expansion from happening. I saw in Utah, for instance, that you had to have about 45 different interviews, job interviews, to be able to qualify for Medicaid expansion, for instance.
Well, Lord knows that the Missouri legislature side, particularly the GOP version, that they are very good at putting up restrictions and barriers for people to get what they actually have even voted for. I do think they need to be very careful, though. The Medicaid vote is a huge example of how long strong advocacy has to work, really for a decade, to turn public sentiment and turn public minds. But once you have done that, and I believe they have, there is not a going back, and there will be a penalty if legislators try and roll this back in a way, particularly if they do it in a very underhanded way.
And it doesn't go into effect until July 1st of next year, though, Michael, right?
Yeah, and I was expecting that, as Mary just indicated, that maybe the legislature will throw some obstacles up, and they might. But at the same time, this was injected into the Missouri Constitution as an amendment. That makes the requirements for executing this much more difficult to avoid, and that's going to be a big deal.
But wasn't that true, though, of medical marijuana? Wasn't that true of Clean Missouri? And you still were able to walk back elements of those things. Steve.
You know, I think there's going to be some upfront cost to this Medicaid expansion. I think everyone agrees on that. The long-term cost we can debate. One thing I think people need to watch really closely going forward in Missouri is what will this added cost mean when it comes to funding for K through 12 education and higher education, where I also work at UMKC. There's a potential here for Medicaid expansion to pay for that at the expense of education in Missouri. People have to watch that very closely.
Okay, in other news this week, are we about to experience another round of shutdowns? Last week, Mayor Quinton Lucas and Kansas Governor Laura Kelly said they were both considering imposing new restrictions, a big target being bars.
If we continue this trajectory, I will have no other choice than to recommend that we move back to phase two of the Ad Astra plan to reopen Kansas by next week. That means mass gatherings would be limited again to 15 individuals, and that bars and nightclubs would need to close.
Okay, that was Laura Kelly last week. What happened? Did they just delay these announcements, or has the changing public health picture convinced them that new restrictions are now unnecessary, Michael?
No, the situation has not improved, but I think Governor Kelly and every chief executive that's running a government is really, really going to be reluctant to step back. What I think would happen, if anything, would be a clampdown on bars. And here's why. The restaurants are pretty well organized in terms of having lobby groups and that sort of thing. Bars and taverns do not have that same sort of organizational lobbying effort, and they, because they don't, would be more vulnerable to it.
Nick, can I just quickly, nothing is more important than how the schools open in the next couple
exactly.
of weeks. I mean, that we're paying attention to bars and mass gatherings, that's important, but the real impact of COVID, at least in August and September, will be told when the kids go back. In 10 days, high school football players are going to start practice again. College football teams are getting together. I mean, the biggest story in COVID over the next 6 weeks, in my view, will be how do schools open, do kids get sick, and what happens if that happens?
Well, let's talk about that a little bit. While it is election week, it is also decision week for tens of thousands of families in our metro. Most area school districts set Friday as the time parents needed to notify their administrators on whether they plan to enroll their children in person or online classes this fall. The majority of our local districts won't reopen until after Labor Day. As we end another week together, is there any evidence, though, that school districts are considering pushing back in-person classes even further, or is the pendulum swinging back to getting kids back in the classroom sooner rather than later, Steve?
Now, I'm not seeing any signs that schools are going to go past the already delayed start of schools, which is in the week after Labor Day, Nick. I think that's what everyone seems to be holding fast to. You know, I'm really glad my kids are older right now. I would not want to be a parent having to navigate this set of choices right now and sort of inconclusive healthcare guidelines. Is it safe for your kids? Is it not? This is tough stuff for a lot of people, and I feel for them.
Steve's right. There's no movement right now around here, but I'm telling you, I think teachers are this close to maybe raising some hell about this. If there's a spike.
There were going to be a lot of teachers that were going to be retiring, particularly if they're of an age where they might be at more of a risk to be in the classroom. And that whole shift in terms of demographics was coming anyway.
What were you doing this time last year? This is what Quinton Lucas was doing.
Of mayor of the city of Kansas City.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Hasn't time flown by when Quinton Lucas raised his right hand a year ago this week? Could he ever have expected to have his leadership tested by mask mandates, shutdown orders, the toppling of statues and monuments and daily street protests? In his inauguration speech, he said his top priority was bringing down the homicide rate in Kansas City. Let's start there. How has he done on that, Dave Helling?
Well, I mean, he wanted the homicide rate or the homicide number, Nick, for Kansas City in 2020 to be under 100. They're well over that, may set a record this year. It remains a difficult problem. It's not only just a moral problem, Nick, it's a political problem. What do you do? How do you solve this problem of high murders? Do you get rid of the police chief? Do you go to local control of the department? Are there more investigators needed? The whole brouhaha over federal involvement and Operation Legend, that story will not go away, and it's really the umbrella, if you will, over the entire first year of the Lucas administration.
When you have almost every big city in America now experiencing double-digit increases in murders, is it unfair, Mary Sanchez, to expect the mayor to fix something which is really now a nationwide problem?
Well, he certainly has a role in what he can do there in terms of an advocate. And I think he's been very good advocate for the community, particularly for the African-American community that bears the brunt of these murders. I mean, it's just, it's horrific. I do think it's unfair, though. And I think people want to try and claim their win that, oh, we got local control or we got rid of the chief. But even those things, not that I'm completely opposed to some of the rationale, but that doesn't solve what is the underlying problems that cause crime and cause particularly high violent crime and gun violence. These are things that have been building for decades. And to think that one mayor can fix it or making one little administrative shift or changing a budget a little bit one way or the other completely disrespects what really drives crime.
One other lingering criticism of Quinton Lucas, Steve Kraske, and it came up to even during the campaign, is that he is somebody who says one thing and does another. I saw Urban League president Gwen Grant saying this week that who is the real Quinton Lucas? In the year that since he's taken office, has he quieted some of those concerns or has he only amplified them?
I think he's amplified some of those concerns, Nick, and maybe no issue shows that more than where he's been on Police Chief Rick Smith. He sort of has played that both ways, showing allegiance and support at times and sort of suggesting at other times that maybe Rick Smith's time has come and gone. You know, having said that, Nick, no mayor maybe in decades, if forever, in Kansas City has faced the kinds of challenges that Quinton Lucas has. A global pandemic, a budget out of whack completely, a homicide rate that is spiking. I give him pretty high grades in general for his energy, enthusiasm, his accessibility. He's everywhere at once. I wonder how he does it sometimes. Yes, he's got some things to work on, but pretty good first year in my book.
As he starts a brand new second year this week, what is his biggest challenge as he begins that, Michael Mahoney?
The same one that he has right now, dealing with the violent crime rate in this town and handling the coronavirus crisis.
What is the biggest challenge for Quinton Lucas as he starts his second year in office, Dave?
Well, the city's budget is in tatters. I mean, they got a memo this week that said, hey, we may have a $200 million shortfall in a couple of years. Some of us were trying to warn the mayor of that back in March, and they passed the budget. They're going to have to do some real refiguring. And I think the pressure on the federal government to help out will increase. Whether the Washington will come through or not is a very open question, Nick. And so I think the mayor and his colleagues will really have to navigate that at a time when the pandemic rages, at a time when murders are continuing to be a problem in Kansas City. It's the second year is going to be quite as interesting as the first.
When you put a program like this together every week, you can't get to every story making our local headlines. What was the big story we missed? The Help Wanted sign goes up for a new school superintendent in Kansas City, Kansas. Charles Faust abruptly resigns after less than 2 years on the job. Is the check finally in the mail after months of testy exchanges? Jackson County finally giving Kansas City a slice of the millions it received from the federal government for COVID relief. There may be no school to go back to, but that is not stopping the state of Missouri from offering you a back-to-school tax holiday this weekend. Starting Friday, you won't pay taxes on children's clothes, shoes, and back-to-school supplies from notebooks to laptop computers. It runs through midnight Sunday. Urban Outfitters announces it's bringing 2,000 jobs to Kansas City. The trendy clothing and lifestyle retailer says it'll open its largest distribution warehouse in the country near the Kansas Speedway. Construction is set to start in October. Can we gather important clues about our community's economic anxiety from an unusual place, the animal shelter? The KC Pet Project reporting a sharp uptick in surrendered animals due to eviction. The Sprint Center name is now officially erased. Get used to saying T-Mobile Center. The new signage now up outside the downtown arena. Another victim of the pandemic, the world's largest barbecue competition, the American Royal, nixing its World Series of Barbecue for the first time ever. The four-decade-old event was scheduled for September at the Kansas Speedway. And humbug! First the Nutcracker, now a Christmas Carol. COVID canceling the KC Rep's biggest moneymaker. The announcement comes a month after the ballet, the symphony, and the opera canceled every performance for the rest of the year. Steve Kraske, did you pick one of those stories or something completely different?
The last sentence of a Joyce Smith column in The Star recently pointed out that the Country Club Plaza has more than two dozen empty storefronts right now. Anybody who's walked through there will notice the deferred maintenance, some landscaping issues. The crown jewel of Kansas City is hurting right now, and you wonder what the future looks like in a very cloudy retail establishment climate right now.
Mary Sanchez.
The death by suicide of Daisy Coleman. It was a rape case from up in Maryville, Missouri, which frankly is where I went to college, so I know that area well, but she committed suicide. And at the age of 23, and it's just a horrible, horrible thing that has occurred now.
Michael Mahoney.
The astonishing defeat of Lacey Clay over in St. Louis, 10-term congressman. He was defeated by Cori Bush, an activist that got into politics through the Ferguson riots a few years ago. But an astonishing story. It's the third time this year the Democrats have taken out one of their own established liberal Democrats.
And Dave Helling.
I'll bring you the sports report, Nick. First, the Royals have started out terribly in this shortened season, and that's an important story for us. Of course, attendance won't be affected because no one can go to the games. On a more serious note, you know, high schools, colleges, the pros all have to figure out if and how they can play in an age of COVID. That's been very, very spotty, and I'm just astonished that high school kids are being asked to go back and play at a time when this terrible disease is raging through our country.
And on that, we will say our week has been reviewed. Thank you to The Star's Dave Helling for checking in with us, along with Mary Sanchez from the Tribune News Service, Michael Mahoney from KNBC 9 News, and keeping you up to date weekday mornings at 9 on KCUR-FM, Steve Kraske. And I'm Nick Haines. From all of us here at Kansas City PBS, keep calm and carry on.